been alluded to, we will not make it possible for those people to live here. We will certainly not make it possible for low-income people or people with housing vouchers or who need public housing to live there. So those kinds of zoning laws are still with us. They're incredibly difficult to dislodge. But it's a lot harder to say, you know, oh, zoning laws are perpetuating segregation than it would be to say, oh, you know, there's not as much overt discrimination as there used to be in the country. And this kind of invisible legal architecture of segregation takes a lot of really sort of subtle and in many ways kind of nefarious forms. You know, this includes things like suburbs building out sewer systems that they know will not be sufficient to support multifamily housing. So when someone comes along and says, I would like to build an apartment building here, the neighbors can say, you know, it's not that we don't want low-income people as neighbors, it's just that our sewer system can't afford it. Or our school system isn't large enough to add capacity for more students. So there are all of these kind of other ways that these patterns are maintained, and these are very, very kind of strong structural hurdles to lower-income people moving into the suburbs. And because race and class are so deeply intertwined in America, you know, these are structural obstacles to immigrant families, Hispanic families, Black families moving into the suburbs too. But a lot of people don't see all of that stuff operating because most of us don't pay a ton of attention to things like zoning codes.
And how has Secretary Carson defended his decision to terminate the AFFH rule?
So in a couple of different ways, he's alluding to fairly familiar conservative ideas that this is too much federal government overreach into the decisions of local communities. He himself has also referred to the Obama-era fair housing rule as an attempt to do social engineering in the suburbs. Again, as Professor Lacey suggested earlier, what we've been doing in the suburbs for many decades is also a form of social engineering. And so that's one of the comments that many people would make criticizing the secretary's opinion. But I think, you know, in many ways, even if you sort of take out the particular issues about race and segregation, he is making arguments that are just much more sort of fundamental conservative ideology, less government, don't expect local governments to do all of this bureaucratic work looking at all of this data and compiling long reports. And, you know, I think that that argument resonates with a lot of people too, especially if you don't want to have to be talking about the more kind of awkward racial implications of all of this.
Well, again, current Secretary of Housing and Urban Development Ben Carson was supposed to join us this hour, but canceled. The invitation to join us still stands. M emailed us, maybe the rule is the problem. Maybe we should take a look at the rule and figure out why behaviors went in the opposite direction from what it was supposed to do. Please ask your panelists if anyone has scientifically studied this question. Shauna, I'll come to you on that.
Well, we now have decades of evidence that the kind of social engineering that Emily talked about, that the government participated in and created in many ways, was what led to unequal housing. But as I said earlier, we have to remember that where you live determines so much else in your life. It determines whether you can build wealth, it determines where your kids go to school, and as we're seeing with COVID, it determines whether you live or die often, because whether it's asthma that your kids may get from the apartment they live in, or pollution nearby, overcrowding. And so we don't need any more evidence to show that we need to work actively to not just get rid of discrimination, but also to repair the damage that discrimination has done. And we should remember, and this isn't just a question of what we can see and the evidence we have, it's the law of the land. The Fair Housing Act, passed in 1968, said that we needed to go beyond just stopping active discrimination and affirmatively further fair housing. And so I believe we have mountains of evidence that this needs to happen. And in fact, what we started to see in the early implementation of the rule that I created under President Obama is that communities were doing more, that they were looking at this information, that they were taking more starting to take more aggressive steps. And this goes back to a point that I made that I think really undercuts Secretary Carson and President Trump's argument that this is, you know, something that was imposing on local communities. I had dozens and dozens of conversations with mayors around the country who were hungry for this information, and they wanted to be able to know, to understand what was happening in their communities, which communities had real opportunity and which didn't, and they wanted tools to be able to actively work against that, to create communities that were more inclusive, that had more opportunity in them. And honestly, I think that has only increased with COVID. Public opinion has shifted and really begun to understand, I believe, how deeply racism is built into our society. And that is, you know, the idea that this rule was eliminated just at the time that there is this awakening in the country after the death of George Floyd and the movement for Black Lives is, as I said at the outset, taking us backwards, not forwards.
Homer re-emailed us, please address the real fears of suburbanites about lower property values and increased crime. My brother-in-law claimed that there was an increase in burglaries and other crimes when low-income residents were moved into the community. Emily, have you found that in your reporting?
There is not a lot of evidence that supports the idea that if there is more affordable or lower income housing built in your community, that your property value will decline. Nor is there a lot of evidence that crime will go up. I should also add that there are not an enormous number of studies about this because we don't have an enormous number of examples of really wealthy, high-income, exclusionary communities that all of a sudden have affordable multifamily housing built in the middle of them. But I think perceptions that this will be a threat to your property value are...